So the next is, how do we know if something is a strong acid? Because strong acids go in one direction, right? Versus a weak acid that has a double arrow and creates an equilibrium. So that's what this section's about, is how do I know the strong acids and strong bases? Because that also is going to influence whether it's a strong electrolyte or a weak electrolyte. And you'll see that if you watch the videos that I did for solution chemistry, when I talk about electrolytes. So that's another way to review. But this is another way to review, is chapter 10. So different acids and bases have different strengths. So there are thousands of weak acids and bases compared to strong acids and bases. So there, I just want you to know there are far more weak acids and bases. In fact, carboxylic acids are weak organic acids. And those, basically every macromolecule that you consume, carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins can all be changed metabolically into a carboxylic acid that feeds into the citric acid cycle in metabolism, which is really the centerpiece. So acid and base strength is related to whether or not it's a stronger or weak electrolyte. Basically, does it dissociate 100% or only partially? So strong acids break apart 100%. If I take a strong acid, I throw it in water, it completely breaks apart into ions. So that's why we have the single arrow. So if I throw hydrochloric acid, which is one of the six strong acids in water, I will only get chloride ions and hydronium. That's it. There's no double arrow. There will not be HCl. There will be water. And why will there be water? Well, you know, the HCl is the limiting reactant, right? Does that make sense? Remember stoic?
Yeah.
So water's in excess. So what dictates the amount of hydronium and chloride is the limiting reactant, HCl. And the water's in excess, why? It's the solvent. It's more abundant, okay? But it's one direction. There will not be, this'll get used up, okay? Weak acids are different. They don't break apart 100%. They only dissociate less than 1%. In fact, most of them stay as molecules as opposed to ions. So they stay as molecules because they're covalently bound, not ionically bound. So they don't break apart very well into ions. So what do we see? We see a double arrow, right? So here's carbonic acid. Well, it only breaks apart less than 1%. How do we show that? The forward reaction arrow is much smaller than the reverse. Why? These are my major species in solution. So if I throw carbonic acid in water, I mostly have carbonic acid. I will, however, have some of the carbonic acid donating a proton to water to produce hydronium in the bicarbonate ion, but a very small amount. And that's why I have a smaller arrow in the forward reaction. So these are called minor species. I have very few bicarbonate ions, very few. So because I don't have a lot of carbonate ions or bicarbonate ions, this is considered weak. It doesn't do a very good job of giving me a lot of the H pluses donated to water, which is hydronium. So strong acids and strong bases, what do? They completely break apart. So the way they show this schematically is if I take HCl and I throw it in water, water molecules get protonated and I got a bunch of hydronium. And then the chloride ion, which is the conjugate base, I got a bunch of those. But it completely breaks apart. So how do they show that? The green is the chloride, the H plus is white. They show it combining with water to give me hydronium ions and chloride ions. Sodium hydroxide, what does that do? It totally breaks apart into sodium ions and hydroxides. So again, strong acids and bases, 100% dissociation. So there is a large concentration of ions. If there's a large concentration of ions, that makes it a strong electrolyte, because the strength of an electrolyte is based on the concentration of ions. So how do I know my strong acids and bases? Well, it's a lot easier to know the six strong acids and the six strong bases than to know the thousands of weak, right? It'd be easier to memorize the six strong than the thousands of weak. So you just got to know them. Now, again, there's no way for me not to know if you pull this up. If we were in face-to-face, I would expect you to know these three. So, or these six. And this is from another book. Your book doesn't give all six in a nice table like this, but that's okay. So the six strong acids that I want you to know are, three of them are binary, hydrochloric, hydrobromic, and hydroiodic. The other three are oxy acids, nitric, sulfuric. But the reason why I reviewed all the different oxy anions, if you remember, right, we reviewed this. All of these are negative. I know that this is chlorate. So chlorate gives me the chloric acid, but this is not chlorate. It's one more. It's perchlorate. Now, why do I want to know that? Well, perchloric acid is one of the six strong acids. The bases are easier to know. You can go on a periodic table, look at group one. They got lithium, sodium, potassium. You go one over to group, if you go one over to group two on your periodic table, and you guys can look at your periodic table, then it goes calcium, strontium, and barium. Those are your six strong. So you can just go down a periodic table, lithium, sodium, potassium, and then move over from potassium, calcium, strontium, barium. And those are your six strong bases. So it's a lot easier to know the strong bases because you can use a periodic table. So why is it important to know which are the six strong and which are the acids and the six strong bases? Well, if I look at HF, hydrofluoric, what do I notice? It's not one of the six strong. So because it's not one of the six strong acids, it only partially dissociates. So when I throw this in solution, I mostly have HF and I have very few ions. So if I only have few ions, right, it does not dissociate completely, then I have a low concentration of ions and I'm in a weak electrolyte. If I look at ammonia, if I throw that in water, I produce some hydroxides and some ammoniums, but most of it is the molecule ammonia. So only a few ions are present. So again, this is a weak electrolyte. Why? Ammonia is a base, but it's not one of the six strong. It's a weak one. So how do we indicate weakness? We kind of already talked. We use a double arrow. Why do we cover Bronsted-Lowry definition? Well, now that we cover Bronsted-Lowry definition, if we see this, we can still identify, even though there's a double arrow, that this is my acid and water is my base. Why? This is donating the proton. So this must be my conjugate acid, because once the base accepts it, it becomes a conjugate acid, and this is my conjugate base. But I have all of these species in solution. It's not going in one direction. And in fact, these are the major species. So this arrow really should be smaller because this is not a strong acid, it's a weak acid. So can we identify which one are strong and weak acids or bases? So number A, was hydrobromic one of the strong acids? I know I went through that kind of quick.
Strong acid.
It's one of the strong. So this is strong. So again, for the acids, three of them are binary. hydrochloric, hydrobromic, hydroiodic. The other three are oxy. Sulfuric, nitric. So these are a little friendlier because they're derived from sulfate and nitrate. The one that's not as friendly is the perchloric because it's derived from perchlorate. So now, if you look at B, they're trying to trick you. They want you to say strong, but is it one of the six strong?
No.
Oh, it's not nitric acid. This is nitrous, so this is weak.
It should be HNO3, right?
Yeah, HNO3 would be strong, but this is HNO2, so that's not nitric acid. It's nitrous, so it's a weak acid. Okay. What about C, sodium hydroxide? Is that one of the strong ones?
Strong base.
Yes, that one's a little bit easier. Again, mm-hmm. Use the periodic table. Lithium, sodium, potassium, move one over. Calcium, strontium, barium. So again, you guys could look this all up. There's no way for me to know if you're looking at a table. Why am I teaching it as if we were still face-to-face? Because if you're fluent, you're gonna move through stuff quicker and it's not gonna eat up the time because you're always looking through your notes, trying to figure stuff out. What about H2SO4?
Acid.
It's one of the six strong. What about copper 2 hydroxide?
Weak base.
Excellent. So we got it. So that's why it's important to know that, because if it's a weak acid or a weak base, it's in a state of equilibrium and it's a weak electrolyte. It only conducts electricity partially. But we're going to see in the next sections that we're going to have to be able to recognize if it's in equilibrium, can we write an equilibrium constant? What we learned in chapter 9.